building model. So the title of my talk is The Value of Conic Optimization for Analytics Practitioners. So for any person who's optimizing. Here's an outline of my talk. First, some benchmark results that hopefully will prove that conic optimization is something that is useful in practice, and then a summary at the end. Okay, so in general, in optimization, what is the thing that we are working with? Well, the generic problem is that we are minimizing some kind of function f of x, and x belongs to some set. So the x is our decision variables, f is some function. X is subject to various constraints, telling us what we can produce. In general, this problem is quite hard to solve. So it is sort of my claim that although you can use this problem to formulate whatever you like, then it's too generic to be practically useful because the problem will be too hard to solve. Okay, so what people have been doing instead is that they look at a linear problem. So you're minimizing a linear function subject to linear inequalities or inequalities. So essentially a problem looking somewhat like the one we have there. So we have an explicit structure that everything is linear. The data for this problem is very simple. It's just the C vector, the A matrix, the B vector. Whereas for the generic problems, we have to have a function f of x, and this function might be hard to evaluate, and it's to some extent also hard to input in the computer. Whereas for this linear problem, it's just some very simple data. We know that a linear problem can be solved with powerful algorithms because we have the simplex algorithm and we have interpoint methods. We don't have any issues with local and global optima because the problem is convex, so any local optima will be a global optima, and we can very easily verify optimality via duality. But of course, this model has a restriction. We cannot handle non-linearities. So if the problem we want to solve requires us to deal with some nonlinear relationship, then we can't use this model unless we sort of linearize the model. So the question is there some kind of compromise problem class that allows us to deal with some nonlinearities while keeping almost all the good properties of linear optimization? So we want a problem that deals with some linearity, but it's almost as easy as a linear problem. And perhaps not that surprisingly, then I will present conic optimization as the answer to that question. Okay, so the generic conic optimization problem has the form minimizing some linear function subject to linear equalities or inequalities, and then the variables. In this case, we kind of think of variables or the variables vector. It's subdivided into smaller vectors, and each of those smaller vectors has to be member of a convex cone KK. Okay, so you know, normally when we generalize the linear optimization problem, we introduce nonlinear functions. That's not what we're doing here. Here we keep the linear objective functions, the linear constraints, And then instead of saying x greater than equal 0, then we say x in a convex cone. Okay, and here on the next slide, I define what I mean by a convex cone, and it should be pointed. So essentially, a convex cone is of course a convex set. So if you take any two points in the set and draw a line between those two points, they are in the set. Moreover, if you take any point in the cone and multiply that by any positive scalar, then it's in the set. So we know from linear optimization that we have a dual problem, and that's a very powerful concept, because we have a candidate optimal solution, and we can find a feasible solution to the dual problem, and those two, so the optimal value of the dual problem is of the dual solution is equal to the optimal value of the prime solution. If they are equal, then we know that we have an optimal solution. For conic optimization, we have a dual problem, and it's almost the same as in the linear case, because we are maximizing BTY subject to C minus ATY belonging to the dual cone. So if we've been in the linear world, we wouldn't have said the dual cone, we would just have said greater than equal 0. So the only difference is instead of greater than equal 0, then we just say that the dual constraints has to be in the dual cone. And the dual cone is defined as below, and it's exactly the thing that you get in the linear case, if you look at that special case. So in general, the dual form is as general as the primal form, and both problems are convex, and the objective sense is not really important. So then you might primal and vice versa. Okay, so the beauty of conic optimization is that you get a separation of data and structure. So the data is the C vector, the A matrix, and the B, and the structure is the cone K. Whereas in general convex optimization, or in general optimization, you're just saying minimize f of x, but that f of x can be anything. It can be a quadratic function, it can be some language exponential function, it can be whatever. And inside that f, there might be some data. There's no separation between data and structure. But here we have data are C, A, and B, and the structure is in the cone. So essentially, the way we think about it is that we have a convex cone, and normally we can classify this convex cone usually just to belong to five different cone types. There's a very nice paper by Nimorowski that discusses this in more details. It's a very nice read. I can recommend them. Yes. So essentially, conic optimization is very, very similar to linear optimization. Okay, so today we are only covering five cones, and those five cones are the linear cone, the quadratic cone, the semi-definite cone, the exponential cone, and the power cone. And I'll show you what those cones are in the subsequent slides, but there's already now quite a bit of evidence that almost all practical convex optimization problems can be formulated using those five cones. And there's a paper by Miles Lubin that shows that all the instances in a mixed integer nonlinear programming library can be formulated using those five cones. So I think that's quite amazing. If you think about all convex optimization problems in the world where you can formulate those problems with only these five cones, most of them, not all of them, but the majority, it seems. Okay, so next I will cover what are those five cones. Okay, so the first and basic cone is the linear cone, so it's just x greater than equal zero, right? Because that's convex set, and if you take any point in that set and multiply by a positive number, it will be in the set. So that is the most basic cone. Then the subsequent cone is the conic cone, and there's two variants. There's a normal conic cone, and then there's a rotating conic cone. So the last one is the rotating conic cone. So this cone is also sometimes called the ice cream cone, because if you think about this KQ set in three dimension, then it's exactly the ice cream cone, right? So it is basically a point, and if you think of the point as a circle and you slowly grow the size of the circle, then you get a cone, or you get the ice cream cone. Okay. So clearly the ice cream cone is a cone, right? Okay, I should press here. So what can we model with the ice cream cone? Why is that interesting? We already know that with the linear cone, we can do quite a lot, but with the ice cream cone, we can do more. So if you take t comma x in the quadratic cone, then it's the same as saying t greater than equal the 2 norm of x. So then that means using the quadratic cone, we can model constraints with alpha with the norm of affine expressions, because x, you can there you can plug an affine expression like ax plus b. Then if we go to the subsequent line and say half comma t comma b times x in the rotating quadratic cone, then we get t has to be greater than equal a quadratic term with a positive semi-definite Hessian. So with the quadratic cone, we can model things with a 2 norm, and we can model convex quadratic constraints. By the way, I didn't mention that. So there we have the quadratic cone and the rotating quadratic cone, and we can use which one of them that we want, because an orthogonal transformation of the quadratic cone gives you the rotating quadratic cone. So in some sense, we don't have to deal with the rotating quadratic cone, because the standard quadratic cone, the first one of them, is sufficient, but from a modeling point of view, it's nice to have both of them. So it's kind of syntactic sugar, as we say in computer science, to have the rotating quadratic cone. So now then look at the set t greater than equal 1 over x. X greater than equal zero. So has this anything to do with the quadratic cone? Yes, indeed it has, because if you say x comma t comma square root 2 in the rotated quadratic cone, then these two sets are the same. You take a piece of paper, then you can easily verify that. Even things like t greater than equal x raised to 3 over 2, you can write with two rotated conic quadratic constraints, so s comma t comma x in the rotated three-dimensional rotated quadratic cone, x comma 1 over 8 comma s in the rotated quadratic cone. And similar, if you want to model the set t greater than equal 1 over x squared, then you can model that with two rotated quadratic cone. So with the quadratic cone, we can model a lot of simple convex sets, even those who doesn't really look that quadratic, but also convex quadratic constraints and things with the 2 norm. Finally, then I have written up the definition of the so-called harmonic mean, and it's defined there, t less than equal n times some sum of the inverse of the elements x, and then raised to the minus 1. And that can be modeled using a bunch of rotated quadratic cone. So we introduce some additional variable ZJ. So we say ZJ, comma, XJ, comma, T in the three-dimensional rotated quadratic cone. And then we sum the sets to N times T divided by 2. And you can easily prove that the last constraint, so to speak, is it gives you the harmonic mean. So that means if we can write models where we allow to use the quadratic cone and the rotated quadratic cone, we can model many convex sets. Okay, let's try to look at another example what we can do with the quadratic cone. So a normal linear inequality is A times X less than B. And here, when we write such an equality down, we essentially assume A is known precisely. But in many cases, A is not, you know, it's not known exactly. Maybe it's something we have measured or some other way. There's some kind of uncertainty. So we can define something called a robust inequality. So instead of assuming A is exactly known, we assume A belongs to an ellipsoid. And that ellipsoid is defined there. So it's all the sets where Z is an affine expression of Y, and the norm of Y is less than 1. So Y has to belong to a ball. So an affine expression, an affine transformation of a ball is essentially an ellipsoid. So depending on how your uncertainty is or noise in the model, then you get it, then get a certain edge, right? So by having a non-empty ellipsoid with a certain form, you can specify how inaccurate your A is and where the noise is, so to speak. So you can rewrite, fairly simply rewrite the robust inequality into the equivalent form where you have something with a 2 norm. So a bar times x plus the 2 norm of a x times y less than b. And you can write that to a conic quadratic inequality as shown at the end of the page. So you can see what is going on here is that the term hty, 2 norm of that, is pushing you into the interior of the inequality. So that's why X will be, say, a robust solution, because even if you change X a little bit, it will still be feasible to the original problem. Okay. So conic optimization has been quite useful in robust optimization for this reason. Finally, I guess you already heard about this at this conference or workshop. We have the semi-definite cone, positive semi-definite cone. So the positive semi-definite cone is the cone of all positive semi-definite matrices of a certain dimension. And that's quite clearly a cone. And that's very useful for a bunch of to approximate a bunch of non-convex problems like in graph partitioning. You can also do the nearest correlation matrix. But I will not say much about the semi-definite cone here. Okay. So the three cones we have seen until now belongs to this class of symmetric cones. So this is a very special class of cones. They have the property that they are self-dual and they are homogeneous. And then I've written out what does it mean that a cone is homogeneous. Well, a cone is homogeneous if for every x, comma y in the relative interior of the cone, there exists a linear map A such that A maps X to Y, and that linear map maps the cone to itself. Okay, so how many symmetric cones do there exist? Well, in fact, there's only exist five. So there's two more cones that we haven't discussed, and something like the positive semi-definite cone of Hermitian matrices with complex of quaternion entries, and then there are some fairly esoteric 3x3 positive semi-definite matrices with octonion entries. I always thought the last one was very strange, but there are some very good reasons that this is not so strange. But normally it's only the three cones that I discussed in the beginning that's used in practice and not the two other cones. And these five cones are closely related to Georgian algebra. Okay, so we know from the theory of Georgian algebra, we know there's no other cones that has that are symmetric. So we can use we can invent a symmetric cone that will allow us to handle logarithmic term or x raised to some power. So this is, maybe you already know this. So in the recent years, we really wanted, I wanted, and other researchers wanted to extend the algorithms that we have for solving problems over symmetric cones to non-symmetric cones, and then that has been a very hard thing to do, but we finally managed at least to some of the non-symmetric cones, and now I will try to discuss what are the useful non-symmetric cones. The first one I'm going to show is known as the power cone, and it's defined as on the first line. So essentially you have a bunch of x variables, and those variables you raise to a power alpha. If it makes it easier for you, then you can assume that all the alphas in that formula is strictly positive, and the sum of the alphas is equal to 1. So it's basically something like x raised to 1/3, x1 raised to 1/3, x2 raised to 1/2, and so forth. And that has to be greater than equal to the 2 norm of another vector, right? So what can we do with the power cone? Let's try just look at the three-dimensional case. So we say t, 1, x, the power cone alpha, 1 minus alpha. So that is the same as saying t greater than equal, the absolute value of x raised to 1/alpha. So clearly if you take alpha 1/3, then essentially what it's saying there is t has to be greater than equal the absolute value of x raised to the power 3. So the first line there underneath examples show you that you can build models with x raised to some positive power greater than 1. Whereas if we say x, 1, t in the three-dimensional power cone, then if we take, for instance, alpha 1/2, then essentially we have the square root x has to be greater than equal the absolute value of t. So we can build models with something like x raised to 1/2 or 1/3 or 1/4 or something. So a lot of convex terms or convex inequalities of one variable we can model with the power cone. Finally, let's look at x, t in the power cone where all the alphas are equal to 1. That is the same as saying the product of all the variables, of all the n variables, raised to 1 over n has to be greater than equal the absolute value. In fact, what we have on the left-hand side of the inequality is the geometric mean. So once again, we saw with the quadratic cone, we could model the harmonic mean, and with the power cone, we can deal with the geometric mean. And it turns out in practice, at least that's my experience, when you're working with convex models, you are often working with either the norm of something or the mean. It might be hidden, but that is often what you're seeing. Okay, let's try to look at an illustrative example. So we have the convex function y raised to minus a half. Then, so you can plot that function or analyze the second derivative, then you will see this is a convex function. Then, in fact, we know that if we take the perspective function of that one, it's still a convex function. So the set I have there, x times y divided by x raised to minus a half less than t, that is a convex set. So this implies, so if you take the a square on both sides and move a little bit around, then you get the absolute value of x raised to the power 3 has to be less than equal t squared times y. And then if you raise both sides to 1 over 3, then you get the absolute value of x has to be less than equal t raised to 2 over the 3 times y 1 over 3, and that's equal 1 t raised to 1 over 3 times t raised to 1 over 3 times y raised to 1 over 3. So in fact, you can see what we get here is that the absolute value has to be less than the geometric mean of the vector t comma t comma y. Okay, so this essentially proves that the set, the first set y minus a half, we can model that with either the geometric mean or and hence also the power cone, right? Oops. So the dual power cone is defined like that. It seems that it's fairly rare that it pops up in practice, but there's a recent paper by David Papp about the sum of non-negative circuit polynomials, and there it pops up. It turns out that the power cone is self-dual. You have to use a different inner product than the one that we are used to, but it's not homogeneous. The cone is not homogeneous and it's not symmetric. So it doesn't belong to the cone to the set of symmetric cones, the power cone. Okay. So the final cone that I'm going to deal with is the exponential cone. So essentially, take the perspective function of e of x, so e raised to x3, and then if we take the perspective function, then we multiply that by x2, and then e raised to x3 over x2. And that gives us the exponential cone. So if you move down in the exponential cone, then you can see in the first line, you have something x1 greater than the perspective of e raised to x3. X2 has to be strictly greater than zero. And then we have an additional thing in order to make the cone closed. Yes. Instead of taking the union, we could have removed the last line, and then we could have written closure in front of the first set. So what can we use this for? Well, let's try and take a three-dimensional vector consisting of t, 1, and x in the exponential curve, then that is the same as saying t greater than equal e of x. So that, perhaps that's not that surprising. With the exponential curve, we can model a lot of convex terms involving the exponential function. Now, instead, say x comma 1 comma t in the exponential curve, then that is the same as saying t less than equal to the logarithm of x, right? So that means we can, with the exponential curve, we can also deal with convex terms involving the logarithmic function. Okay, so we need all the permutations of t, 1, and x. So the last one is 1 comma x comma t in the exponential curve. And that is the same as saying t has to be less than equal minus x ln of x. And it is fairly well known that x times logarithm of x is called the entropy function. So that means with the exponential curve, we can also model the entropy function. Finally, let's take this, the vector y comma x minus t in exponential curve. Then that is the same as saying t greater than equal x times logarithm of x divided by y, and this is called the relative entropy function. So with the exponential curve, we can model a various number of sets, convex sets, involving the exponential function, the logarithmic function, and various forms of exponential function, entropy functions. So, just a quick example. There's something that is called the analytic center of a polytope. And what you're doing there is you're maximizing sum of logarithm of x subject to ax equal b and x greater than equal 0. And that is conic representable using the exponential curve as shown below. Yeah, so essentially we need one conic constraint for each variable, xj comma 1 comma tj in the exponential curve. Okay. Another set involving logarithm exponential function that pops up frequently is what's known as log sum exponential. So there you have a sum of exponential functions, as you've seen there in the parentheses, and then you take the logarithm and then you have to say that's less than equal e. In fact, the left-hand side of that inequality sometimes it's taken as an approximation of the biggest element in x. And you can rewrite that using n constraints, or you know, you have to introduce an additional variable set j for each xj. Say set j comma 1 comma xj minus t has to belong to the exponential curve, and sum of the sets has to be less than 1. So typically, convex expression involving log sum x terms, we can rewrite using the exponential curve. Okay, here's another set. Can we rewrite that to be conic representable? Yes, indeed. So we have, and the set is log of 1 plus 1 over x times y. So how do we rewrite that? And x comma y has to be greater than equal 0. Well, first of all, we say log of e to the r plus e to the s has to be less than equal t and r equals 0, because then you have e raised to the 0 is 1. And then you just say e raised to s is another variable, has to be greater than equal than the last term. Okay, and if we rewrite that a little bit further, then we get, we repeat the two first, the first inequality, and the second inequality and the equality, and then we just take the logarithm to the on both sides of the last inequality, and then we get h plus log of x plus log of y has to be greater than equal zero, and this is clearly conic representable using the exponential cone. So a lot of stuff involving the logarithm exponential functions that even doesn't look like that they are the exponential cone representable can be it if you know a few tricks on how to do it, then you can rewrite it. And this is an example showing how we can rewrite it here. You can also rewrite the classical optimization problem called geometric programming that goes back to work of Duffin, Kotanik, and Peterson using the exponential cone. There's a function called the Lambert function, and also model with the Lambert function using the exponential cone. So you can model a lot of complex things with the exponential cone. Okay, there's of course a dual exponential cone, and it's defined as shown here. And the exponential cone, in contrast to all the cones we saw previously, is not self-dual and it's not homogeneous, and hence it's not a symmetric cone. Okay, so I claim that almost everything, almost all convex optimization problems can be modeled using a conic optimization and these five cones. But it's not all of them. And here's an example. So there's a function called the logarithmic mean of temperature difference. And that's the first function shown there. That function is, in fact, not convex, but the inverse function is convex. And at least at this moment in time, we don't know whether it can be modeled using the five cones that discussed on the previous slides. We think it's not the case. We think we need more cones. And there's a blog post on the MOSEK blog, on the MOSEK blog, discussing this function. And this function has acquired a number of applications in chemistry engineering. So not all convex functions that we know can be modeled using the five cones, and this is one example. Here there's another convex function we don't know how to represent using the five cones. Maybe it can be represented using the five cones I've shown you, maybe not, probably not. Okay, let me see what time is it. Okay, we are sort of time. So here I repeated the primal and the dual problems. So here are the first the primal problem, x and the primal cone, and then I stated the dual. Here I just introduced slack variables s in the dual problem. So if xk has to belong into the primal cone, the sort of correspondent dual slacks has to belong to the dual cone. And so it's very easy. It follows from the definition of the dual cone that if you have a primal feasible solution and a dual feasible solution, then take the difference between the objective values, the so-called duality gap, then it must be positive. And given some regularity conditions, then we know that there's an optimal primal dual solution such that the primal objective value is equal to the dual objective value. And we know in case a linear optimization problem has an optimal solution, there's always a dual solution, feasible dual solution that has the same objective value as the primal optimal solution. That is not the case for general cones. For instance, let's look at minimizing x raised to the minus first, x greater than equals zero. We already know that this is conic quadratic representable. So the optimal solution here is not attained, because the optimal solution is, if you let x goes to infinity, x will go as close to zero as possible. So zero is sort of a lower bound on the optimal objective value, but it's never attained. So that's a strange thing. Similar, if we look at the next optimization problem, then if you take e raised to minus x less than equal zero, so this is a convex constraint, then there's no feasible solution, finite, only as x goes to infinity, you will get closer and closer to being feasible. Okay, so in general, in conic optimization, a lot of strange things can happen if a certain regularity conditions are not met. Okay, we have a few more facts I'll show you. So if you can find a kind of a dual solution such that BTY is strictly greater than zero and ATY plus S is equal to zero, then we have a proof that the primal problem is infeasible. So we have certificates of infeasibility. Just like in the linear case, and this is essentially sort of the generalization of the Farkas lemma. Similar, if we can find an x such that CTX is strictly greater than zero and AX is equal to zero and X is in the primal cone, then the dual problem is infeasible. Okay, so that means in conic optimization, we can either have, the most normal thing is that we can have an optimal solution, or we can have a certificate of primal infeasibility or a certificate of dual infeasibility. And then there's some ill-posed cases beyond that. That is, in general, if you go to just convex optimization with my f of x, g of x less than zero, you have much harder time having certificates of infeasibility. So also here we see that the conic optimization model resembles the linear case really a lot. And if you can do something in the linear case, you can almost always also do that in the conic case. Okay, so this was a quick introduction to what is conic optimization, what can it be used for, what kind of models, what kind of things can you model using a sort of a basic conic framework. And I also presented a few facts about the optimality conditions and Farkas lemma for specifying certificates of infeasibility. Okay, so far so good. So the next thing I'm gonna show you is this really interesting in practice? And of course, it's only interesting in practice if you can solve problems with these cones quickly on a computer reliably. Okay, so let's start by conic quadratic optimization problems. So I ran some problems on some fairly recent hardware using an AMD CPU. This is known as the generation 2 AMDs. There's now a generation 3 that is even faster. This machine had 24 cores and 128 megabytes of RAM. I used MOSEK version 9.2.30, and I just used 8 threads because most users are using 8 threads to solve their problems. All timing results I present on the subsequent slide are world clock seconds. And I took test problems from the public benchmark library, cblib.cde, and some problems supplied by our customers. So here are the problems that I used for the first test. So the problems comes from different applications. So there are some of the problems are from structural engineering, some traffic modeling, some Wi-Fi networks. We had a customer looking at the trajectory of soccer players. So you can see soccer trajectory. Swiss quant is some financial. The 2013 at the end are filter design. The UV problem is something with imaging, I think. And you can see these problems. First, the number of constraints in each problem. So in the first one, we have 10,645 constraints. The number of kinetic codes, the number of variables, and there's no matrix variables. So there's no semi-definite component. So you can see, for instance, the changing. I think the changing problem has a bunch of three-dimensional codes. The one with PP minus N something. The multi-body problem has only one code, so it's probably originally a kinetic problem. So these problems represent different application areas and different dimension, and it goes from fairly small problem to fairly big problems with up to something like 2.5 million conic constraints and 8.5 million variable. So from small to quite big. And these are the sizes after pre-solve. So MOSEK reduce the problems before optimizing it. So could we solve those problems? Yes, indeed. First, I showed the primal objective value, and then the number of figures that are estimated to be correct in the primal objective value, the number of iterations, and the time. So you can see the time that took to solve these problems was from about 0 seconds up to maybe 2 minutes on this computer, maybe like 3 minutes. So even though those problems are quite big, then we can solve them in a few minutes time. So for instance, the problem called CKS, C minus QSSP 180. When I started in research in the mid-90s, this problem could only be solved on a huge vector computer, and it took forever to solve, and now it solves in CQSP, it solves in 11 seconds. Okay? So a lot of things have happened during the last 20 years with respect to solving optimization problems. Some of it is because we have improved the software, and other of it is from the computers have become much faster. Okay, so the final set of test problems I'm going to show you is a set of problems involving the exponential cone and the power cone. Once again, I use 8 threads. Wall clock times are still in seconds, and the benchmark problems are from cblib and customer supplied. So there you can see the problems. There's some involves Wasserstein regularization of some imaging problems. The first one is a financial problem. The entropy is some problems involving entropy functions. The XML is maximum likelihood problems. There's something with relative entropy, red ent. CBF underscore MR, MRA 02. I think it's a geometric optimization problem. So once again, these represent different application areas. You can see the number of constraints, the number of conic constraints. So the first one has about 1 million linear constraint and 1.2 million conic quadratic constraint, and about 4 million variables. So once again, these rates range from fairly small to fairly big in terms of number of variables and constraints. Once again, here I show the problems, the primary objective value, the number of significant figures. And you can see we would like to have 8 figures. In one case, we only get 6, but in most cases, we get from somewhere between 7 and 10 correct figures. The number of iterations for these models is somewhat higher compared to the conic quadratic case, but still quite reasonable. 146 in the worst case. No, 212 in the worst case. And you can see the time in seconds. So it takes about 10, 15 minutes for the problem that took the longest. So that means that, at least I hope, that can solve these conic optimization problems fairly quickly and fairly accurately in a reasonable amount of time. Okay.
There is a question.
Let me summarize.
Erling?
Yes, sir.
There is a question from the audience.
Can I ask a question? So these examples that you give, they are all convex.
They are all convex, yes.
Okay.
That's the beauty. You cannot. Okay. So, you know, there's something called disciplined convex optimization. So that's the thing that is implemented in CVX and CVX part. And in disciplined convex optimization, you have to follow some rules. And if you follow those rules, you know the end result is convex. We call this extremely disciplined modeling, because once again, as long as you model with linear, you can only model with linear constraints and those 5 cones, and the end result is going to be convex. There's no way you can model a non-convex problem within this framework.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so extremely disciplined modeling is conic modeling using linear quadratic semi-definite power cone and exponential cones. There might be more cones in the future, but for now, it's at least these are the cones that we can deal with. So this is inspired by disciplined modeling by Grant Boyd and Yi. All those models can be solved efficiently using a primal dual and tier point method. And it preserves all the good properties of linear optimization. They are simple. The data are explicit. They are structurally convex. That means, you know, if you say f of x is a quadratic function, then you cannot say whether this model is convex or not, because that depends on the Hessian on the quadratic function. But these are convex by structure. It's no matter what A matrix, what B vector, what C vector you input, the model is convex. So in some sense, this is much stronger form of convexity, because just by looking at the model, you know it's convex. You have a duality theory, and it's almost as nice as in the linear case. And there's no issues with smoothness and differentiability. You know, normally, if you're minimizing f of x subject to g of x less than equal to 0, you have to think about, is f smooth? And if it's smooth, I can use this class of optimizer. If it's not smooth, I should use this other method, maybe bundled methods or something. We don't have such issues in conic optimization. clearly the class of problems that we can deal with is more restricted. But if you can fit your model into this class, you know that you have a very high probability of solving your model.
I ask another question.
Yes.
So they are convex. Are they full dimensional convex, or they are living in some linear space?
I think not, because you can, you know, we are not saying anything about, if you mean by the interior, or you can have linear dependencies in the A matrix or something like that, if that's what you're thinking about.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's not necessarily full dimensional.
You know, it sort of depends what you mean by full dimensional, but I would think with any reasonable definition of full dimensional, that's not the case, you know. Okay, so if you want further information, so I'm from the company MOSEK, so I like MOSEK. You can go to our websites, you can get a trial of the software, and there's a free academic license. You can solve linear and conic mixed integer problems, and there's a bunch of interfaces for C, Java, Julia, MATLAB, R, Python, whatever. We have a documentation website or page, and on that page you can download a modeling cookbook, and this cookbook has a lot of information about how you convert convex inequalities into conic form, and a lot of interesting stuff about conic optimization. So I can recommend that you take a look at that. There's even a cheat sheet, so there's a one-page document you can print out and put on your table. And I think that contains all the most common used tricks for rewriting a convex optimization problem into conic form. On our GitHub site, you can find various tutorials, typically in Python, implementing various optimization models. Okay, and then there are some references here at the end. But I have reached the end of my talk, and so the whole purpose of this talk was to convince you that you should take a look at conic optimization if you're solving convex optimization problem, or maybe even approximating non-convex problems. You can sometimes approximate those by conic problems, and I think this is a very interesting area, both for research and for use in practice. And thanks for listening.
Okay. Thank you very much, Erling. Are there any questions from the offline audience?
Yeah. Well, maybe. Okay. So, can you hear me from here? I should move closer.
Maybe you can closer.
Yeah. So you mentioned the cookbook that you've written to help, let's say, user model their problems using conic optimization. I wonder as well if you're working on pre-solve, especially to like reformulate problems automatically, for instance.
Reformulate them automatically?
Yeah.
Basically, I don't believe that's a good idea. It's not gonna work. It's gonna be an error-proof thing that you will hate in the end.
Okay.
So we are explicit not doing that. And let me just give you a simple example. Let's take that you have a quadratic inequality, right? Then what you have to do to write it into conic form is that you have to compute some kind of factorization of the Hessian of the quadratic term. And this might be slightly negative semi-definite. And then the software will come out and say, I couldn't convert your problem. And then you're sitting there and scratch your head and you don't know why. There are softwares like CBX that does this, and it works nicely in most cases. And as long as it works, it's nice. But whenever something breaks down, you will scratch your head, and you will hate that software because you don't know what went wrong. So we are not going to do that. We will let other people do that. And in any case, rewriting convex models into a conic form is not that hard. It's a fairly small set of tricks that you have to learn, and then you can do everything. But I mean, that is something people argue about, whether you should do one way or the other. But my bet is at the end of the day, people are not going to use automatic tools.
Okay, thank you. Bernard, do you have?
Well, there are questions on the chat.
I have one offline question. So you mentioned that the last cone, the exponential one, is not self-dual and hence not symmetric. Could you comment on the algorithmic implications of that? Did you have to modify the interior point algorithm significantly that you were using before for the symmetric cones?
Oh, yeah.
Do you want to elaborate on it a little bit? Or?
Well, so the issue is there is something called the Nestor alternate algorithm, primal dual algorithm for symmetric conic optimization. So that is the most used algorithm for symmetric cones, which it's implemented in Situmi, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
And so that exploits a very central feature of symmetric cones, and it's a bit like, I don't know if you remember, there was this linear map that was part of the homogeneity of that the cone was homogeneous, and it turns out that for all symmetric cones, you need a barrier function, and if you have a barrier function, then for the symmetric cones, there is, if you evaluate the Hessian of the barrier function in the so-called scaling point, then it maps the primal point to the dual point. So there's this scaling point, and this gives rise to a symmetry property that makes it very easy to deal with the primal and the dual algorithm simultaneously. But such a scaling point cannot exist for non-symmetric conic optimization. And various researchers had tried to work around this issue. So together with Joachim Dell, I have a paper based on work of Levent Tunsel. And there we sort of define a scaling matrix that is fairly close to the scaling matrix employed when you are optimizing over the symmetric cones. But of course, it's not the Hessian evaluated in a certain point. It's rather the Hessian updated using a BFDS formula. And then you can create an algorithm that is very close to the algorithm for the symmetric cones, but it's different. So there's a paper by Joachim Dell and myself published in Mathematical Programming recently that discusses this algorithm. There are other researchers that have developed different different other different algorithms using different types of ideas. So as far as I remember, one type, one class of algorithm is based on an idea of Urinesov, which essentially, so his idea is in symmetric conic optimization, you have this scaling matrix, but he shows that this scaling matrix exists in the, for the non-symmetric cone in the neighborhood of the central pass. So in this type of algorithm, essentially what you're doing is that you're sort of taking what is known of an affine step, so instead towards optimum, and then you're moving away from the central pass, and then you take some steps back to the central pass, close to the central pass, that you have a scaling point there or something like that, and then you can take another affine step. So there's a different approaches to deal with this lack of homogeneity of the cone.
Okay, thank you very much. Are there other questions from the audience? If not, we can come to the questions from the chat.
There is one by Long and Mike. Yes, you can click on chat. First one is maybe you can unmute his the long question.
Right. So Hong, if you want, you can ask the question. You can ask the question directly, or Erling can read it and answer it.
Yeah. Let me see.
Yes. Okay. I would like to ask about the parallelization of MOSEK. So that's I have runs. I have tried the SDP of very small maximum matrix size at large number of scalar variable and contains, and I see that MOSEK is better than SDP3. So I would like to ask, does this effect needs come from that MOSEK parallelization to speed up the Cholesky factorization, right?
That could be one factor going into that. In general, you know, MOSEK is a commercial product, and I've spent 20 years tuning on that. I don't think Kim To has spent 20 years tuning SDP3. I doubt he did much work on it for many years. So I think there's many factors that goes into why MOSEK is faster than SDP3 for a certain problem. But parallel, I don't know whether SDP3 is parallelized. If it's not, then that would certainly be one factor.
Okay, thank you. So I know that SDP3G doesn't use parallelization to speed up the Cholesky factorization. And so I have another question. So when I use MOSEK to solve my linear relaxation of around 5,000 variable, scalar variables and around 2000 contains, so I receive the feedback MOSEK running 52 a numerically large bound value, and so it's specific for the contains. So, and the output is absolutely incorrect. So I mean that's MOSEK doesn't work well when I solve the linear relaxation, and also for the SDP of very small maximum matrix size and larger number of the contain and the scalar variables. So if you know, you can help me explain this and how to improve this issue.
So you are doing an STP relaxation of some kind of non-convex problem.
No, I mean here is I solve the relaxation for the polynomial optimization.
Yeah, but it's quite frequently like this that if you start looking at the STP relaxation of some higher dimensional polynomial optimization problem, you get problems that are numerically awful. So all this business of polynomial optimization, no one ever discussed, or at least it seems to me, it's very rarely discussed whether the relaxation is something that makes sense when you have to solve it in finite precision floating point numbers. And often when we have looked at it, when you're using, for instance, higher order Serre hierarchies, then the higher orders, they get really crazy numerically and you can't solve them. So most likely the problem is that your relaxations are numerically awful. That is the most likely explanation. That's the best thing I can tell you without seeing the problem.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, we have a question from Mathieu Besançon. Could you unmute yourself and ask your question directly?
Yeah, hi. Can you all hear me correctly?
Yeah.
Perfect. Fine. Thanks a lot for the talk. Yeah, this was very instructive. My question is mostly about, so you argued for extremely disciplined convex optimization, so formulating everything as conic problems up front. I was wondering if you saw some instances or some cases where keeping some nonlinearity and exploiting them in the solution process was better than converting everything to a linear conic form. As in, for example, so there was a recent paper by one of the MOSEK developers that showed that projecting onto the exponential cone itself is very tricky, like, as in it can be numerically unstable and very quickly pathological in some cases. And so because of that, would it be interesting to still keep some things as nonlinear, say a nonlinear objective, and then the constraints are exploited as structured conic constraints to, for example, avoid to add a lot of exponential cone constraints everywhere in the formulation that would be otherwise very well structured.
Well, the short answer is no, because we have this primal dual framework, and if that only works with cones, and I'm not going. You know, MOSEK used to be able to deal with functions, and this is from an implementation point, just from a work point of view, it's awful, and you can't really mix that. If you want to do that, maybe you can do it in first order method or something, but it's not something that I'm going to do. I come from there, and I just concluded that this is a bad idea as long as you want to do primal dualing to your point methods. Also, it's my experience, if you can sort of do a primal dual sort of in tier point methods for a problem in on functional form, then you can also get the same sort of complexity of the linear algebra when you're working with it on the conic form. It just requires maybe a bit more work. And it's a long discussion, but the short answer, no, we are not going to do that, and we don't believe that's a good idea.
So you mentioned compared to, say, first order methods, but even, say, a solver like IPOPT does support smooth differentiable functions, nonlinear ones.
They probably have a good time getting their stuff to work sometimes.
Oh, yeah, I'm not saying it always works.
Let me tell you what the issue is. The issue is that an iteration consists of a Newton step, right? So you're linearizing the problem. So you have a nonlinear constraint, think about a curve, and then you compute the tangent, and then you move in the tangent space. So if you were feasible, you are losing feasibility. And so then you get into an issue. How much feasibility do I want to lose in order to gain optimality? And how do you balance these two things? This is a very tricky issue. And this is not very easy. I can tell you, I've worked on this stuff and I just gave up. You know, in conic optimization, you don't have that issue because all your constraints except the conic constraints are linear. And so when you're linearizing those, you are always moving toward feasibility. And the hard nonlinear constraint, like the semi-definite constraint, you are always staying interior and feasible with respect to those. So that's why I don't believe in this stuff within the primal dual method, and I'm not going to spend time on it.
Right. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Okay. The next question is from Monique. Could you please unmute yourself and ask your question?
Yes, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for the nice talk, Erling. I just wanted to ask a question about the comparison, because you gave numerical results for quadratic cones and for exponential cones, but no results for STP. So how does STP solver compare with the solver for exponential cone?
Well, what I would say, if you have a problem with logarithmic function or exponential function, and you can somehow approximate that with STP, then that is going to lose compared to dealing with it directly. But otherwise, you have a bunch of three-dimensional cone, and you have big semi-definite matrix variable. I mean, what do you mean by comparing? What will help us you of rewriting the power cone, the quadratic cone, or the exponential cone into something semi-definite? That is going to be a bad idea compared to dealing with them directly.
This I can see. I was not suggesting this. But your experience is that this is very exponential cone works very well. No, I'm just asking because they are now very much used for signomial optimization, for instance. So it's nice to know that the codes, the solver are working well with the exponential cones.
I think we are quite satisfied with the way that the code currently works for the exponential and power cone, and it's about as robust as dealing with semi-definite cones.
Okay, thanks.
Can I have a follow-up question on this? What is the demand from your customers in terms of the newly introduce power and semi and exponential cones compared to the more traditional linear, quadratic, and semi-definite programming cones?
In general, the linear cone is of course the most widely used. Then quadratic cone is number two. There's a number of users who model various convex power terms like x raised to 3/2. So they are now switching to the power cone because that is more convenient from a modeling point of view. Then there's a few, we also had some users trying out the exponential cone, but in general, whenever you put out something new like the exponential cone and power cone, it will take some years before people start picking up, but what I'm pretty sure about is, at least for a long term, the quadratic cone is going to be much more used than the exponential and power cone. But I think the exponential and power cone also have its usage.
Okay, and the SDP cone, have you had any clients using it?
We have. I think there are. In general, SDP is very, very little used in practice. I mean, commercial, trying to make money with SDP, it's very few in my experience. And I think the major market is in structural engineering.
Okay, thank you. I believe there is one more question in the chat from Vitsibuka. Could you unmute yourself and ask the question?
Yes, hello. Thank you for the talk. I wanted to ask if there is some possibility to do a solution refinement, or sometimes called polishing, to obtain high accuracy solutions directly from MOSEK. And to give you some background, I'm dealing with semi-definite relaxations of polynomial programs, which are like numerically not very nice. So what I'm doing right now is that I solved the problem in MOSEK, and because I need high accuracy, then I run like external refinement routine to obtain high accuracy, and I was not able really to get to higher accuracy with MOSEK directly. So I'm asking, like, if have I missed something, or is this something like this planned in MOSEK?
It's a natural thing to ask about it, but it's definitely not something we have on the short-term agenda. I kind of think that if you really need high accuracy of your SDP, it probably takes a lot of time to get that high accuracy solution. And of course, if you're trying to prove a theorem, then that is important. But my experience is that the people who are willing to pay money for your software, they don't want to spend forever. Then they will do something else. So I don't see the big, you know, there's not a lot of money in this for us, you know. So it's not something that has high priority, and I don't think we will address this issue anytime soon. Sorry.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for your answer.
Okay. There is one more question from Michal Kochvara. Could you please unmute yourself and ask it?
Yeah. Hi, Erling. I suspect your answer will be similar to the previous question, that there is no commercial use or that. But a question about non-symmetric cones. Some time ago, there was a paper by Joachim Dell and then Martin Andersen about non-symmetric cones of sparse positive semi-definite matrix with order sparsity. Shall we see anything from that in MOSEK?
This is a very good research question, and we were kind of thinking doing something about that, but Joachim Dale, which I worked together with on this non-symmetric conic stuff, left the company. So at least in the short term, it's not something we will work on. But I think it's a very interesting topic, and it's probably a good topic for a PhD. maybe even Martin is looking at it.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions, online or offline? If not, then thank you very much again.